very happy to welcome David Gabai from Princeton, who's given colloquium talk. Come in.
Okay, thank you. Thank you, Stasia. So, anyway, thank you for the invitation to speak here at Rutgers. So the title of the talk is Maximal Cusps of Low Volume. So I'd like just to start off and just say a few words about what I mean by a cusp and then a maximal cusp. But before I should say that what I'm going to talk about, well, to me at least, is this very interesting interplay between sort of basic hyperbolic geometry and topology with a lot of rigorous assistance by computer. Now I should say as a disclaimer that actually the computer part hasn't been sort of completely rigorized. I mean you'll see in a bit, but you have to at some point we'll be understanding some parameter space and looking at some functions and anyway there's controlling Randolph error and things like that and at least things like that have worked in the past and it seems. So anyway, you could just take it for a grain of salt, whatever. What I'm going to say. I mean, but subject to this. I mean, that's. So, well. Okay. So here. N. I'll try the big one. So, N. Is going to be a hyperbolic. Three manifold. So when I say hyperbolic three manifold, I mean a three-dimensional manifold, which has a complete metric of constant minus one curvature, and actually the manifolds we'll be talking about are also finite volume, so complete finite volume manifolds. So the way we think about hyperbolic three space. Is so in terms of here in this lecture, in terms of the upper half space model, so x, y, z, where z's greater than zero, and the hyperbolic metric is equal to the Euclidean metric in the upper half space, sort of scaled by this factor 1/z. And so if N's this hyperbolic manifold complete in finite volume, then N is going to be the quotient of H3 modulo some group where gamma's in the isometries of hyperbolic space, which is equal to PSL 2C. So PSL 2C are 2x2 complex matrices with the determinant 1 up to sort of two matrices are the same if they differ by just a sign. So in particular if you have Z goes to AZ plus B over CZ plus D. Then if A, B, C, and D are complex numbers, then this gives a way of mapping the plane to the plane. And so that's the way PSLTC acts on the extended plane, the sphere. And so there's a natural way to extend it so to a conformal action on the upper half space. And the restriction to the upper half space with this metric is preserved under this action. Matrices are one of the beauties of this is it's all very concrete and matrices, you can multiply them together and do various operations. So therefore, it's a hint that working with such things are amenable to computer calculation. And I mean, it certainly goes back to Bill Thurston in the 70s, where he was just using computers to explore topology and geometry, hyperbolic space. And so there's sort of a long history that goes back to Bill. Actually, Bob Riley, was using computers to try to construct hyperbolic structures in certain link complements in the three sphere in the 60s. So we want to talk about maximal cusps. So to start with, what's a cusp? Before I say that, it goes back, I guess, to Margolis, I believe, in the 60s, where if you have, say, a complete hyperbolic three manifold in particular, then if you pick a number sufficiently small, say smaller than what's known as a Margolis number, then the set of points in this manifold that have injectivity radius smaller than that number are topologically of very special type. So for example, you might have a closed geodesic and some neighborhood of a closed geodesic, and if that geodesic's really small, then all the points in that neighborhood have small injectivity radius. So Margolis would say that the points of small injectivity radius are either neighborhoods of short geodesics or cusps. So a cusp. So that's isomorphic to, well just topologically. So just topologically, here's our manifold, extremely sort of schematic picture of this three manifold. Then a cusp is sort of an end of the manifold. And so the remarkable thing is that topologically, this end is homeomorphic to torus cross a half open interval. But Margolis tells us geometrically that this end is a very special type. So metrically, well, it's of the form x, y, z, such that, say, z is bigger than or equal to 1. So everything lying above and including some plane in three space, sort of modulo some standard z plus z action. So here we are in upper half space, and if you just here's this plane, and if you take some of your favorite different translations, and then you mod out by that, then such a thing is that's a sort of a standard action. That's what I mean. And if you look at everything above this height, then this is what we mean by cusp. And so. As you notice, that if you just look at any of the horizontal planes, then they're all tori, and if you fix and of course the m and the n is essentially a function of the end. So and because of the scaling, you could see that different planes, that the various slices here are all tori that are just scale equivalent. And their cross-sectional area goes to zero exponentially fast. So here's maybe a little fact that's worth noting, which is that the volume of this cusp is exactly equal to one half of the area of this boundary of the cusp. So we all can compute this Euclidean area, especially if modulo, with given this, whatever, if we know the height, well, okay, the height, say it's 1, so this is actually, you know, the same. The restrictions, Euclidean metric and the hyperbolic metric. So this, the 1/2 the area of this torus is equal to just this three-dimensional volume of the cusp. So, right. So, okay, now, as I mentioned, that the group is the isometry group acts on the upper half space. So if this is this, say this this manifold is parametrized, so this is the cusp, then you could ask, well, what are the images of the cusp under the various elements, various covering transformation, various elements of the fundamental group? So, well, I mean, a little fact is that, well, okay, just out here, here's sort of the cusp. But if you apply elements of fundamental group, it's going to take this cusp to little, well, little or big balls that are tangent infinity. So this is a ball that's tangent infinity. It just happens to have infinite radius, and its tangency is sort of at the point at infinity that we see. But if you look at other balls that are sort of round balls, well then these balls by themselves, I mean without the action, are also metrically isometric. So right. So therefore, if we have a manifold, Margolis says there's this end like this, and if we just look at what's, so here's the manifold, but its universal cover is hyperbolic three space. So what's the preimage of this? Well, the preimage of this, well, we could arrange it one preimage is, say, this standard thing above height one, but all the others are these balls. Of course, these, you know, the points at the endpoints at infinity are so dense in the sphere at infinity. So now this is one cusp. Now, I mean, the fact is that we could just say, okay, what if we sort of expand this a little bit, just move it down, instead of at height one, point 0.99 or something. Well, this thing just moves down, and the z plus z action's sort of the same. And well, the effect is that these guys sort of grow a little bit. So the fact is that we can sort of expand this guy down, and these guys in turn will be growing. And at some moment they'll be sort of a tangency. So we can only expand so far, kind of like Morse theory. If you have a Morse, a point, and you're just going out distance, at some point, the manifold starts crashing into itself, and you get the various critical points. So therefore, well, then you could just maybe change coordinates, you just expand this thing, and it touches itself, and that moment where it touches, that's the cusp, and it's sort of maximal. That's what I mean by maximal cusp. And so this talk is about maximal cusps of low volume in hyperbolic manifolds. So right. So here is, well, an open-ended question, which is, well, what are, well, the hyperbolic three manifolds, well, with a low volume maximal cusp. So, of course, for this question to make sense, you have to say, well, what do you mean by low? So if you pick a number, can you sort of list all the manifolds which have a cusp whose volume is smaller than, say, or equal to this number? And That's the question that I want to address. So here's a theorem. So is there a question? No?
I was just wondering if what Maximal meant again.
Okay, so here's this torus, and here's this sort of, you know, nice metrically standard end. But now if we just take this, we just look at sort of expanding this torus, simply just moving down, you know, for every t, you could just look at the points metrically distance t from this torus. And the fact is, since this manifold is finite volume, eventually this torus is going to sort of crash into itself. You know, not the way I've drawn it here, but when you make this big enough, it's at a certain point, there's going to be points of tangency, and the moment where it's, you know, exactly tangent to itself, that's what we mean by the maximal cusp. So here's the theorem. Yes? So this is joint work with trying to just get all the names right in the right alphabetical order, but I won't somehow. So it's Robert Haraway and Rob Meyerhoff and Nathaniel Thurston and Andrew Yarmola. So theorem is that if N is a complete hyperbolic three-manifold with a cusp of volume less than or equal to 2.62, then N is obtained by sort of Dehn filling one of 22 two or three cusp manifolds. So what I mean is this, is that, well, this manifold I've drawn here has one cusp, but you could just as well imagine that this manifold might have several cusps. And so, right. Now, okay, so this schematically has three cusps. Now, suppose I take like one of them, say this one, and I just remove the end. So now this end is just a torus. So now we have a manifold with boundary, and the boundary is this single torus. So what I can do is just take this guy, which is meant to be a solid torus, and I could just glue this solid torus to that solid torus, taking boundary to boundary. So this type of operation is known as Dehn filling. It essentially goes back to Dehn, 100 years ago. So the claim is that if you have a maximal cusp of a volume bounded by this number, then there's 22 particular manifolds with the property that you can get all the manifolds with this small cusp by just looking at the original one, at these 22 guys, chopping off one or two of their cusps and just filling them in. So it's possible that that you just do the trivial filling. You just have this manifold with a big cusp to start with, or you could just do a lot of filling. So, but let me just make as a side remark. Of these 22 manifolds, only one of them has three cusps, and all the others have 21 others have two cusps. So here's a link of three components, and the complement of this link is known as the magic manifold, and this is the three cusp. This is the unique three cusp manifold. And well, for whatever reason, we actually put in some duplication. I mean, because actually a lot of these guys, probably about half of them, are actually attained by filling one of the cusps of this thing. But so this is our theorem, that somehow we want to understand all these guys, and well, the theorem is that the ones of this type are obtained topologically by just filling, you know, one of these 22 manifolds. So,
by the way, Dave, you want that to say with a maximal cusp of volume less than 2.62?
That's a very interesting question. I say that because every time I give this lecture, I make this statement to someone.
I mean, I could always give you.
I really appreciate it. That it's a maximal, with a maximal, right? Because the fact is that if you just take any cusp, as Lee observes, that you could just, no matter how big this guy is to start with, if you just chop it off there, then it's small. So the title of this talk is Maximal Cusps of Low Volume. So thank you for correcting this point. So before I give you some hints about, you know, how something like this might be proved, let me.
So could n in this theorem, could n have other cusps?
So it's possible that you have a multi-cut, let's say a two-cusp manifold, maybe even three-cusp, certainly three-cusp, that were one of the cusps. You just, like, I'm pretty sure the magic manifold, it's if you just fix one cusp and just expand it out, that its volume is of this type. So yes.
So could have another cusp with a bigger volume.
Well, yes. I mean, there's right. I mean, it could have another cusp of bigger volume a priori, and yes. So, I mean, in fact, I think there are some in here that have that property. So let me tell you some applications. I mean, for me personally, I think
this is the volume of the cusp, not the
manifold, the cusp. The cusp. So for me personally, I think this is like just really interesting in its own right. But let me mention some applications of this.
That kind of sounds like a really sort of dumb philosophical question. Why wouldn't you expect the same theorem to be true with? So you're sort of saying there aren't that many with the maximal cusp of low volume, right?
Yes.
So why would you expect the same theorem to be true with that inequality reverse?
Inequality reverse.
Yeah. So why is it?
Or to put it another way, why would you expect any finite number in place of 22?
Right. I mean, in other words, maybe there are only a finite number whose volume is bigger than 2.6, or bigger than 10 or something. Why?
Yes. So,
Is there a cheap proof of that theorem with the 22 replaced by some, you know, unspecified finite number?
Well, yeah, so 2.62 is I mean, it's actually a theorem of Ian Eagle that if you have a three manifold with a cusp of a volume less than three, with a cusp of volume less than three, then that manifold is automatically has finite volume. In fact, the volume is actually bound, is there's actually a uniform upper bound to the volume. So from that theorem, then you could just, you know, when you're talking about numbers less than three, less than or equal to three, then just by you know, Thurston Jorgensen theory of, you know, Dehn surgery, then if you just pick any number less than three, less than or equal to three, then there's some number, maybe 22,000, which has this feature. But for this particular number, we're producing sort of, you know, something concrete. So having mentioned Eagle, let me mention in the same paper where he proves this thing, he makes the following question. Which is what are all the manifolds with a cusp, with a maximal cusp of a volume, well, less than or equal to 2.2 4/7. So he's interested in listing all the manifolds of volume at most 2 4/7, which is, you could all make this calculation, which is like 2.571, which is less than or equal to 2.62. So, right, and so this gives an answer of sorts to this question. And the reason that he was interested and the relevance of this particular number is that if n is a manifold, say with one cusp, and it has sort of non-hyperbolic surgeries, fillings of dis has two of distance well greater or equal to seven. That implies that its cusp volume, it's less than or equal to 2 4/7. So, I mean, this sounds sort of funny, but remember that what is surgery? That means that filling. That means you cut off the end, the boundary is a torus, and then you fill in a solid torus. Now, a solid torus has a particular curve on it, which is the curve which bounds a disc. So there's lots of ways of filling in a torus boundary with a solid torus. And so, you know, basically for every relatively prime pair of integers. And so here's, you know, the boundary of the manifold. And so you're just sort of just gluing in one way, gluing in another way. So you could look at this curve goes to some curve in the torus, and this curve goes to another curve. And this, you know, distance means just the geometric intersection number of the curve. So anyway, that somehow that if these curves intersect a lot, like at least seven, then the cusp can't have too large a volume. And the reason this in turn is interesting is that if this guy, this manifold has at least sort of nine non-hyperbolic surgeries, non-hyperbolic fillings, well, that implies that that again by Egel is that the volume of the cusp is smaller than this number. So, right. So, but it's, I mean, Thurston sort of, you know, in his revolutionary work on the figure eight non-complement, sort of initiated the study of non-hyperbolic surgeries on a cusp manifold, and there's been a lot of progress since then. So therefore, since we've, you know, close to nailed down all the manifolds with a big cusp or small maximal cusp, it's obtained by filling one of these guys, then we have sort of, you know, reduced this question to sort of understanding just the fillings of exceptional fillings of these particular manifolds. So therefore we have this theorem. Well, whatever, you know, how many people are there? Five plus Tom Crawford, who's a student of Rob Meyerhoff. So that is that. Well, the figure eight knot complement is the unique, well, hyperbolic manifold with, well, actually it's gonna take a little more work to get down to nine, but with at most 10 non-hyperbolic surgeries, fillings. I should mention that Meyerhoff and Mark Lackenby showed that a one cusp manifold has at most 10 exceptional fillings. So, but this now actually proves that this thing's unique, and maybe with a little luck that this will be the only one that has sort of nine exceptional fillings. So, okay, so that's sort of one application, type of application. And second one is volumes of hyperbolic manifolds. So, well, I guess in 2007, Rob Meyerhoff and I and Peter Milley, sort of culmination of work of a lot of people, showed that the Weeks manifold is, so the Weeks manifold is this, the smallest closed orientable is the least volume. Closed hyperbolic three manifold. So now we could improve that a bit, which is what's the second smallest one, which is known as, it's sometimes known as the Meyerhoff manifold. So that's the second, and a manifold that's known as vol 3. That's the third.
Good name.
So I should say that, you know, that work that was in the 90s by, you know, myself, Rob Meyerhoff, and Nathaniel Thurston, we were, you know, looking, doing some stuff, and we're in particular this guy vol 3 had played a particular role, and we called it vol 3, and people criticized us because it wasn't necessarily the... it might be inappropriate to call this guy vol 3, but anyway, so it's... it really is vol 3. So, right. So, and well, I won't write this down, but we've been, I mean, when it comes to one cusp manifolds, Rob Meyerhoff and Chris Chell identified the first two. And then in part, in proving this, we identified three through 10. And to do this, actually, we need to identify all the her one cusp manifolds of volume less than equal to 3.07. And well, so now we could identify one cusp manifold number 11, 12, and 13. I hope you find that as exciting as I do. So, let me just mention one more thing, which is that, I mean, this has actually been a long-standing problem, so here's sort of third application, is that, well, the figure eight knot plus the sister manifold are like the unique manifolds, or the unique, say, one cusp manifolds with least volume maximal cusp. So, and that volume is, well, 2 root 3. So it's, 1.73 or so. So here's, some applications of this. Root 3.
Two times that.
I think I just wanted.
Yeah, that better be without the two.
Yeah, I think it's certainly without the two. My mistake. Thank you. So, So let me give you some hints as to why a theorem like this might be true, and how should we go about thinking about it. So here's sort of the cusp, say the maximal cusp at height. We've parametrized it, so it's height 1, and there's sort of these balls that are lying below, and here's sort of the two translations M and N that generate the Z plus Z. So the thing is this: if we have a manifold with a particular cusp, volume cusp, then it turns out there's sort of another manifold, possibly the same one, which is, in some sense, the simplest one, simplest manifold with this particular cusp. More precisely, is that we have this manifold and it has this translation. Now, the fact is this ball is, and this ball up here at infinity, these are equivalent under the fundamental group. So just for fun, if I just put a little arrow going from this ball to this ball, then there's a covering transformation which takes this ball to this ball. But if this ball goes to this ball, then this ball goes to somebody else. And it's actually not one of these guys, because you can see under the translation the arrow is going to be pointing up. So this ball is going to go to sort of another ball over here. And so under the covering translation. So this information is what we think of as sort of the information determining the cusp, but really it's the z plus z plus this transformation. And well, if you think about it, the set of such you know, the set of such groups, well, lies within a six real dimensional parameter space, right? Because this M, I mean, if you just normalize things, so this is height one, M, whatever, that's some real number. But the choice of N, well, that gives you two more parameters. And then when this ball goes to this ball, then this ball goes to this one. So this point at infinity, well, you could see there's sort of two dimensions of where it can go, but there's also sort of a rotational factor. So the point is that there's this three parameters will produce for you, well, a subgroup of the group of hyperbolic isometries. Here's one element, here's another element, and then there's this third element which takes this one to that one. And so if you give me something like this, I give you a parameter, and conversely, you give me a parameter, I can give you such a group. So, and this restriction that you put some bound on the volume, that makes this parameter space a compact parameter space. So basically, you have this six-dimensional ball, which of parameters for these type of groups. And right, so actually, Egel, Kohler, Schalen call such a thing a bicuspid group. Now, as you could see, that even for M and N, that in general for a random such group, the group's not going to be discrete. So it's going to take like a little bit of luck to choose a random element. Well, a random element is certainly not going to produce for you a discrete group. So here's where the computer sort of gets put into action, where you take this cube, in six-dimensional cube, and you just sort of just chop it up into pieces and you sort of analyze it appropriately, and it turns out that there are these sort of sub-varieties, just maybe 85 of them, which live in this cube, and has with the property that if you have a point that's not on a sub-variety, then you're not going to get sort of a discrete, you know, torsion-free group of this type, and furthermore, I mean, well, there's this Shimizu-Luttbacher theorem, which an application of that says that if you have this variety and you're not on the variety but you're sufficiently close, then sort of an application of that says that you're also not going to be sort of a relevant group that is discrete and torsion free. So anyway, the upshot of all this computer work is to find these varieties. And these varieties sort of are determined by sort of a word in M, N, and G. And a little fact is that the exponent length of these words are less than or equal to 7.
So what's G?
G, oh, sorry, that's a good question. So G is the transformation that takes this guy to this one. So, right. So if you give in three parameters, that will determine an M, N, and G, and then you look at this word So the point is, if you just give in a random word, you could ask, well, a random word corresponds to an element of the group. And you might say, well, what does this random word do to this ball? Well, that random word might take this ball to, say, this ball, which is problematic since these balls are supposed to be sort of pairwise disjoint, at least their interiors are. And if you see something like that, well, that's a problem. And so, but on these varieties, that's where, you know, this this word is equal to the identity. I mean, you know, that, well, even on if you fix a variety, typical point is not going to be discrete. But a necessary condition to find sort of a discrete torsion-free group is that this word is going to be the trivial word in as an element of the isometries of H3. So again, this is where the computer plays this big role in just going to work and well, extremely clever work is done to actually to do this type of thing.
Is the computer used in discovering that list of words, or in discovering the varieties associated to each individual word?
So, okay, that's another that's okay. There's two questions here, and so, well, you know, in this search. There's not like actually a huge number of possibilities here. So actually you could just sort of test out sort of small g length exponential length words, and you'll find some varieties that do a pretty good job of, well, you know, these words, and you look at the sub, if you're given a word and you look at you know, parts of the parameter space that it sort of kills, so to speak. I mean, that a lot of the parameter space is killed by words that are fairly small. But somehow, you know, the brilliance of Nathaniel Thurston is to be able to, and actually, and Andrew Yarmola is to be able to. You know, do this type of thing. So, right, but as Lee sort of recognized, there's the next challenge, which is okay. You have one of these varieties. Okay, now what? So here we go back into topology, where we're here. We just here we are on you know some particular you know variety some corresponds some word. Well,
I hesitate to ask this, but do you have an interesting word?
Yes. If you ask me to say, do I have an interesting word that I could produce in 1 minute as opposed to like 7 minutes? The answer is no.
Okay, carry on.
So, okay, but here's now. There's this. Okay, in some sense, you could just forget about everything I've said before, because now we enter the realm of sort of knot and link theory for horribles in hyperbolic space. So here we are in hyperbolic space, and. And well, okay, suppose we just start, like, say, this is, you know, this ball over here. And well, okay, so we look at this word, and this word basically tells us by just sort of path lifting that we can start here and, you know, do like M and N, that's like lying on here. But when you go across G, well, then there's this sort of, you pop over to another ball, and then you pop over to another one. So a word of length 7 corresponds to sort of a necklace of horribles of length 7. So, right, so in the universal cover, there's like this countable collection of horribles, interiors pairwise disjoint. But remember that it's a maximal collection, so each one has lots of balls that are tangent to it. And the fact that there's a word of length 7 means that you can actually find, like, you know, cycles of 7 tangent balls that, you know, that go around in this infinite system. So let me just do a sort of a diversion. But if you're you could ask the question, which is, to me, a really interesting question, which is, if you're given like just a collection of tangent horror balls, is this necklace of balls, is it knotted? Is it unknotted? So unknotted means that you can find an embedded disk, which you know traverses this, you know, traverses this, you know, these balls, and actually, it's a little theorem that sort of like if you have a necklace of a less than or equal to 8 necklace, then it's unknotted. And actually, I think our conjecture is it's true for like less than or equal to 13. So this is actually slightly tricky because not only does this disk have to avoid these balls, but remember the balls are tangent at infinity. So there's actually sort of necklaces of length 14, which in some sense, just viewed from the, you know, the cores is unknotted, but it's not knotted. It is knotted because somehow the disk wants to go through these points at infinity. But, okay, so there's this question of knottedness, but then there's the question of linked. So if you have this necklace, say eta is this necklace, then we say it's unlinked. So, and suppose it lives in a collection of horror balls. So there's this infinite collection of balls, and this is maybe, you know, 7 in a row, and we say it's unlinked if it bounds a disk, sort of avoiding the other balls. Avoiding sort of other balls. See, the problem is this, is that you can have, you know, this link of 7, but there could be a ball in here, and say a ball at infinity, and you know, even though this is unknotted by itself, this ball and this ball are sort of, you know, causing sort of a linking. And actually, Colin Adams and Karen Knutson showed that for, 6 necklaces, then, Jim, okay, sorry, let me just state a theorem, which is that if BI is sort of geometric, that is, it's a system of horror balls coming from a group action on a cusp manifold, and eta is a less than or equal to 7 necklace, then eta is unknotted. So I should say, by example, this is false for 8. And for 6, actually, that's a theorem of, an unknotted necklace is in a geometric system is unlinked. So for n equals 6, this is essentially due to Adams and Knutson. So, right.
David, is the earlier less than or equal to 8 necklace unknotted theorem, is that also about a geometric system of horror balls?
Sorry, this one?
No.
This one? 8? 8, actually, 8 is 8 is 8. 8, I think, is universal. I think the conjecture is that if you just take any 13 horror balls, that one's tangent to the next, and...
Well, this isn't as part of any system. This is just
a
tangent cycle of horror balls.
Yeah, yeah, true. You know, maybe I should add a technical word, minimal. So, I mean, you might have sort of excess tangencies between those, and but if you just if you look at the true tangencies, I mean, not sort of ones that are coming through. I would guess that just unequivariantly, this is, you know, 13 by themselves. That would work. So. Well, if you had you know, something like, I mean, this is still unknotted, but it, like these full-size balls, and this is, you know, one going to the next. But here's this extra tangency. And so somehow that, you should just think of that as just being like shaved back a little bit, because somehow that's, so that's what I mean. So if you allow yourself to shave back for false tangencies, then I believe this is true, and actually maybe even allowing such. But in any case, the question is, why would you care about all this knot theory stuff? And the point is this, is that, I mean, if you just think in terms of Morse theory, here's our manifold, and here's this cusp, and now, you know, here's the schematic picture from afar. But maybe from another point of view is that when this thing, when you expand this a little bit further, eventually crashes into itself. So when it crashes into itself, if you just, well, maybe to compactify it, so just take a little torus here, then before it compactifies itself, just topologically, you just see torus cross the interval. So between here and there, that's just interval. But now you just expand this a little further, and there's this first point of tangency. So when you just go a little bit further after that, and just assuming that's sort of generic, so it's just happening at once, then the effect of that is adding on a one handle. So you add on a one handle, you know, effectively just after the first point of tangency. Now the point is that if you have this word corresponds to the fundamental group. Well, if you just say fix a base point, well, that corresponds to some path in this surface of genus 2. Now, a priori, there's no reason that curve should bound a disk on the outside. What we do know is it's homotopically trivial to the outside, but there's no reason why it should bound a disk a priori. And however, I mean, basically the whole point of all this knot theory is that in fact you can find a disk. So there actually is an embedded disk that sort of lies to the outside. So I mean, a little fact is that if you just take a torus and then you just, you know, just, you know, add a two-dimensional handle, well, you know, just topologically, depending on whether the boundary circle is separating or non-separating, say in the case of it's a non-separating curve, then you sort of add a two-handle, then topologically you get sort of a manifold with a single torus boundary. And well, I mean, okay, there's some minor technical issues, but if this is the only cusp of the original manifold, then this knot theory tells you that you actually geometrically can put on this two handle. So therefore, well, you know, other topological facts tell you that in fact there's really a small number of two handles you can add on. I mean, just for whatever reason, but there's but the point is, now you get this torus here. And just a basic fact about hyperbolic three manifolds, that if you have a torus sitting in a hyperbolic three manifold, then it's either boundary parallel or it's inessential. So, and if it's inessential, I mean, you know, ignoring some technicality of like a cube with knotted hull, is that basically to the outside of here is a solid torus. So the upshot is that you start with your random manifold with this sort of small maximal cusp, then because of the geometry and topology, that we could actually find some limited number of two handles that are embedded that sort of live in the sort of in this the complement of torus across the interval in this handle, and then well maybe that's the whole manifold, or maybe it has to get filled in sort of further, but anyway that's sort of the idea. And so in summary is with this restriction we have this parameter space. It's compact parameter space. Extremely clever computer work. Decomposes the, finds some number of varieties in this parameter space. Then, and in particular, the words corresponding to varieties have exponent g length of most 7. And then we developed this sort of knot theory for these 7 less than equal to 7 necklaces. And the consequence of that is that when for these smallish cusps, when we sort of expand out a little bit further, well, in the manifold, it's effectively just topologically adding a handle. But this sort of this theory over here says actually we can just there's actually these embedded two disks that are sort of to the outside, and well, we can add them on, and then we're basically left with these one of 22 manifolds. And so, and this, right, so anyway, that's sort of the idea of how this all works.
Is the unlinkedness equivalent to the statement that you can find this two disk in the quotient manifold, embedded in the quotient manifold?
If you can find this two disk in the quotient manifold that sort of goes around correctly, then that's, I mean, this is a particular necklace versus some random two disk. But if you find a two disk which corresponds to this word that's embedded, then that's essentially saying that this is unlinked. So, actually, there's a technical point here, which is that this guy's unlinked. However, the group action might take this disk and intersect itself under the group. And if that happens because somehow 7's odd, then in fact we can actually find like a 6 or less necklace and. And those are a lot simpler. So, this is actually a stronger condition than there's an embedded disk here, because if it's unknot, this statement just produces you this unknotted this disk, but the disk itself might intersect itself under the group, which is sort of problematic for finding an embedded one downstairs. So actually, so excuse me for going over time, but since Anesthesia mentioned Robert Haraway, I mean, he so one thing is, well, he plays a big role. I mean, he's using variant of his earlier technology. It turns out that manifolds corresponding to like a 4 necklace, there's exactly one. There's 3 manifolds from a 5 necklace, 9 with a 6, and 15 coming from 7. So it's surprisingly few for the necklaces. So if you add them up, 24, 28. So just from this necklace theory, without sort of finer thinking, there's really 28 manifolds, but somehow only 22 arise from our parameter space.
Let's think.
Oh, because if you have there's this issue of separating versus non-separating. So if you have a surface of genus 2 and whatever, there's some stuff down here, and then you add on a two handle over
choices.
Here, then you're gonna get sort of you know, two ends.
I have a question.
Yes?
So earlier when you had the 4 to 5 balls that were tangent to the maximal cusp at infinity.
Yes.
In that picture, I missed what the arrows represented.
Oh, yeah, so that's... Yeah, so so that's sort of a neat thing, which is actually goes back to Colin Adams in the 80s, which is that here you have like this cusp, and then you have like the Z plus Z action. So if you just say you put the base point right at this cusp here, well, okay, just from this, just because of this picture is equivariant under sort of Z plus Z. If there's this ball here, then there's balls sitting at these vertices, and Colin Adams observed that there's actually another tangent ball in there, and the way to see that is simply that if you just think of this ball and just put like a little arrow going from this ball to this ball, then under the Z plus Z, these arrows are pointing up. But on the other hand, this ball and this ball are invariant under the group. So if you take this ball goes to somebody else.
The second ball being the plane. Right, the Z equals one. The Y, the Z equals one plane.
So, well, this.
You had a couple of this balls.
Yeah. So what I'm saying is that this the Adams ball. There's these balls that are tangent and lying below, and the point is the Adams ball is actually another ball. That's tangent that doesn't correspond to one of the, you know, the lattice points, and the way to see that is, here's this ball. And there's a group element, what we call G, which took this ball to this ball. Now, if this ball goes to this ball, where does the infinity ball go? Well, if this one's tangent to this one, then when you apply the group action, this one goes to infinity, so this ball goes to a ball that's tangent to infinity. So it has to be somewhere. So I could just put it there, I mean, for fun. But the point of this arrow is that if this one points to here, this arrow is pointing down, so that's useful because that informs us that you can't have this ball is really not one of these lattice points, because if it was, then we could just apply an element of the Z plus Z and translate this ball back to this one, which would mean that you'd have a group element which basically, I mean, took this arrow and reversed it. Or in other words, there would be an element of the group which just swapped these two balls. And that would be an element of order two, because it's sort of fixing this point. So this one is different. And the point of the arrow is we can just keep track of different balls.
I remember when he discovered that was sort of amazing. It's like, well, that's stupidly simple.
Yes. You know, and like Rob Meyerhoff is like, you know, Rob had, you know, found like the smallest orbifold, you know, cusp orbifold somehow by this, you know, beautiful, using some beautiful Brodsky packing argument. And so he missed that there's this extra ball which sort of doubled the estimate of area, of volume for the manifold. And Adams made this incredibly simple observation and said, well, okay, well, we know what manifold that is, and that's sort of whatever, this Giesecke manifold. So there's a non-compact one cusp manifold of minimal volume, because its volume had to be above a certain number because of packing plus multiplication by two. And so.
Any more questions? So please join us for dinner. Let's thank you.